We call it the Year 2000 International Security Dimension Project. I'm going to call it Y2K as I speak because it's easier to say. But we call it the Year 2000 International Security Dimension Project because when Admiral Sabrowski, the president of the U.S. Naval War College, came to us back in summer 1998, he said, look at what Y2K plus whatever fellow travelers could be going down the pike along with it could do to the international security environment to make it better or worse. This is a classic what-if exercise. We've been asked to imagine Y2K having a substantial effect. Okay, it's not a prediction of what's going to happen. It's our imagining of what could happen if Y2K turned out to be serious. Some people say that's fear-mongering. We say it's like the surgeon coming to you the night before surgery and saying, dismemberment, loss of organs, coma, paralysis. Oh, but sleep well tonight. Don't worry, I'll be there tomorrow morning. Everything's going to work out just fine. It's called full disclosure. Okay? Our goal with this research, and we've briefed it to about 1,000 people, mid-level and above managers in the U.S. government, throughout the U.S. government, throughout the military, is to make sure that no one can turn to a colleague after 1100 and say, I had no idea, dot, 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 that these jokers were going to be involved, that was going to be part of our purview, that this was going to be added to our responsibility, that this was going to be considered Y2K. After you see the brief, after you read the report, you should have every idea. Okay. Second goal of the work is to confront decision makers in the U.S. government with the question, what is Y2K worth to you? If it's not worth much, do not disrupt normal operations much. If you think it can have the impact of a 1973 oil price shock, where I would argue millions died, and they were almost all children, and they almost all lived in developing countries, and their deaths were premature over the following 10 to 15 years due to economic dislocations caused by the crushing debt created by those oil price shocks. Not a usual way we count deaths. But if you want to think of it in those terms, Y2K could be worth a lot. And those are tough things to think through beforehand. All the material here is presented on the web, all the slides, all annotated, so you don't have to take any notes. It's all there. We did it early, got it on the internet because we decided, let's let our audience come to us, and they have come. All the intelligence agencies, the joint staff, various government agencies, industry, British intelligence picked it up, gave it to Tony Blair. He read it, made his entire cabinet read it. The Canadians called us. ABC News called me, asked me where to put all the cameras on December 31st. Interesting conversation. This brief has been just about everywhere. This is to impress you. All these people have seen it in that Washington way. Therefore, you must see it because they have seen it. Enough said. And enough bragging. On with the show.
And now for our feature presentation.
Most people like that start. I've done it three times at the CIA headquarters. They all sit there stony-faced through the whole thing. Finally, I come up to them afterwards and I said, what's the problem? Don't you like PowerPoint? Turns out they're still pissed off about the Tom Cruise movie a couple years back. So I said, don't fall for the ambulance trick next time. Teotihuacan. If you don't know what that is, you're not an REM fan. It's a 1987 song, The End of the World as We Know It. It's also one of the dominant motifs in the internet debate. In the chat rooms on Y2K. It's one of the early concepts, the end of the world as we know it. The opposing view is bitter, bump in the road, B-I-T-R. Teotihuacan has been a defining concept throughout. This is the table of contents. We're gonna give you a bigger picture, hopefully move you off some mental models we're gonna be so bold to assume you're stuck on. We're gonna give you some Y2K models to wrap your mind around this problem that is basically the potential for everything, everywhere to go wrong all at once, which is almost impossible to consider. We're going to give you the M curve of influence, our most controversial concept. Gets me all sorts of names on the internet. My least favorite, Nostradamus of Y2K. My most favorite, Machiavelli of Y2K. Scenario dynamics grid, our black box model as to how we think this thing can go down. Some stuff from the SINCs, meaning the commanders-in-chief of the regional military commands, U.S. government strategies, legacy issues, some things for you guys to consider, because I would argue USAID is the premier legacy organization within U.S. foreign policy, i.e., you're left to clean up the mess. Counterpoint from Wall Street, different perspective, a little bit more optimistic, although their definition of optimism is different from ours. 1997, George Soros made about $3, $4 billion. Indonesia lost the middle class. He was okay with that. Then we'll wrap up with cosmic conclusions. Why? Because Y2K lends itself to cosmic conclusions. And we're big believers that Y2K actually teaches us something about the future as we become increasingly interconnected and interdependent in a global information technology-driven new economy. We think we're going to have increasing numbers of system perturbations that will lead to real conflicts, real bloodshed, real things that the military and you have to worry about. So we'll start you off with some bigger picture. We're going to be up front and tell you where we got our information, because it's really hard to tell what's a good expert on Y2K, what's good data, what's a good line between proper preparation and, you know, believing the hype. So it's very important to get clear with people where you got your information. Basically, we're experts at talking to experts. We leverage the information and minds of about 100 individuals that we brought together over four different workshops. The first workshop we had was in December of last year. We brought together a couple dozen systems experts, meaning everybody from people who know the phone system to people who understand, psychologists who understand societies under great stress, to psychotherapists who specialize in people who hear voices and worry about pervasive technology and the whole shebang. So we stretched it out as far as we could go. We brought them to the Naval War College, to the Decision Support Center, had them all around a big U-shaped table, basically have a small LAN there. Everybody's got a laptop. They can type in all their answers and ideas at the same time. It's a chat room. We asked them to hypothesize, brainstorm, all sorts of things. At this one, we asked them to hypothesize, brainstorm, headlines that you could see in newspapers around the world at various points in time. And we got about 500-600 ideas. They're all posted on the internet. That's what got us the attraction from the intelligence crowd, because they were hungry for that kind of stuff. We created some generic scenarios out of that, collapsed them into one stressing scenario. In January 1999, we brought together a couple dozen regional experts, including some people from USAID, Tony Pryor from PPC, used to be from Africa Bureau, a couple of contractors, Kathy Parker, George Honadel. Brought them to Salve Regina University in Newport, to the Claiborne Pell Center, a wonderful mansion right on the coast, on the cliff walk, beautiful place. Had a three-day workshop. We had them explain to us what they thought a stressing scenario would look and feel like in regions outside the United States. Then we took the information from those two workshops and crossed paths with the wisdom inside the Beltway. Had a one-day workshop then, because these are very busy people. Brought them to the Center for Naval Analyses in Alexandria, Virginia, to their corporate headquarters. And what we had them do was imagine what DOD, the Defense Department, could do to exacerbate or moderate this model that we were creating in terms of how Y2K could fall out. Then in May, we were actually approached by Wall Street itself in the personage of Cantor Fitzgerald, which is a very quiet, somewhat shadowy group. It provides the world's largest secondary market for U.S. Treasury trading. They do $30 trillion of business a year, which is three times the size of the U.S. economy. They take a penny or two off the top of every transaction, allows them to rent top three floors of the World Trade Center. Okay? They're a very powerful group. They're headed up by an individual, former four-star admiral, Bud Flanagan, who wants to bring Wall Street to the attention of the Pentagon and Pentagon to the attention of the Wall Street crowd, because he believes that what each does influences greatly the problem set faced by the other. So we asked a bunch of Wall Street, New York, and Chicago and Europe and Asia types to come together from all these different markets and help us understand what the markets could do to process the risk surrounding Y2K. Since these four workshops, we basically had the complete brief here, and we've been out to all the sinkdoms and a whole bunch of industry and a whole bunch of federal types. So we've briefed this about 75th time. About 3,000 people have seen it. A process view, our one technical slide. I'm going to talk about network instability or failures going from low to high. I'm going to throw out some dates here. I'm going to draw a squiggly line with my squiggly line drawer. Not really based on any data, because I don't believe any real firm data exists. But I'm going to describe that as life as we know it. There's always a certain amount of instability in networks all over the world. Pager crises, satellite failures, electrical outages, Chernobyl, CH46, April 26th, the virus that struck the world. This stuff's out there and it's happening all the time. And guess what? We got all sorts of rules for dealing with that, all sorts of standard operating procedures. Most famous rule, technical term, familiar to anybody in the IT business. Okay? Question we ask ourselves is, if this is going to ramp up over the course of 1999, that's the theory. Now I brief John Koska and he sticks a finger in my chest and he says, there's no evidence of that. Well, there is some evidence, depending on how you want to buy into it. Capgemini is a big consulting firm, global firm. They do a routine survey every quarter of Fortune 500 companies. They say over the course of 1999, an ever-increasing percentage of their number has experienced Y2K failures. Now, what's a Y2K failure? Really good question. What do you want to put in that box? What do you want to keep out? But supposing this thing ramps up over time, our interest becomes acute when we reach some unknown threshold, which you can't define beforehand, beyond which, if we travel, in effect, we're in a new rule set. Now, we've talked to enough people in business, industry, governments, security forces, all over the world, who will tell you, on January 1st, no kidding, I got a different rule set. Most of this different rule set is about how I talk to myself, how we talk within our organization. A few of those rules, though, are going to be about you all, people outside our system, people who we can't control directly, therefore, we mistrust. Okay, no matter what organization you're talking about. Now the issue for us is, at some point you're going to get past this hump, this difficulty, one assumes. Do we ratchet back down to the level of instability we associated with the old rules, our old way of doing things, or do we find ourselves at some higher level at some later point? In effect, does all Y2K provide us is the opportunity to realize that as we become increasingly interconnected and interdependent in a global IT-driven new economy, this inevitably has to go up a little bit over time. And all we've gotten with Y2K is a chance to look and go, duh, that's the way life really is. Give you a sense of how we approach the problem, make sure you understand where we're coming from. I'm going to give you a physical analogy. I'll talk about a military base. I ask you to imagine all those ones and zeros of cyberspace in the background. A military base, a physical space, and then we're going to talk about the world outside. I'm going to draw a line between the two. I'm going to describe that in a military physical sense as the wire, the fence that goes all the way around the military base. But as an IT analogy, I'm going to say that's your firewall. So think of any organization. There's an inside, there's an outside, and then there's a firewall that separates them. I'm going to break down the history of the Y2K problem as follows. Up until about the spring of 1999, everybody was focused with what we call inside the wire issues. The IT analogy here is to your intranet, your LANs and WANs and whatnot. And we call those the known knowns problem set. That's where the remediation was focused, making sure all your computers can talk to all your computers. About the spring of 1999, whether we're talking government, military, industry, we noticed everybody started to move out a little bit beyond that problem set, largely because they got done doing all the remediation and got focused on what we would call crosswire issues. The IT analogy here is to the extranet. We call that the known unknowns. This is figuring out your dependencies and connectivities with the outside world. For a military base, that's the pipes, the sewer pipes, the water pipes, the electricity. And you find out all of a sudden Aviano Air Force Base in Italy doing all those operations in Bosnia and whatnot, it shuts down pretty quickly if you turn off the electricity. It goes 2 or 3 days and then poof, Cinderella hits midnight. Okay? But the spring of 1999, the focus here. About the fall of 1999, people started realizing, boy, there's a world outside that we have to worry about still, what we would call the load issues. We call it outside the wire. The analogy IT-wise is to the internet. We call that your unknown unknowns. That's the stuff you can't control that can jump back and bite you. That's your normal business. So if you're an electrical company, you say, I think I got the generation down. I think I understand the grid. But boy, I'm still worried about those people and what they may do with the load issue. Are they going to want extra electricity, less electricity? Is it going to be erratic in terms of their demand? If you're the military, you're worrying about political military crises out there. Your normal business stuff. This is where we've been all along. This is where our focus has been. When we started this process back in August of 1998, everybody said, who cares about that? I got problems here. I got to figure this stuff out. That stuff's way out there. Who cares? A lot of people care right now. When we did the workshop here 2 weeks ago, frankly, it was the M Bureau saying, you know, we started with this problem because you gave it to us. But if there are problems in the developing world, that's not our problem set in M Bureau. We're in charge of making sure computers talk to one another in IRM. Okay? But if you have problems delivering aid, or if China goes down, or you have difficulties in your countries, that's not my problem set. That's your problem set, the rest of the bureaus, because that's what you guys do. So it's a question of ownership as we get closer to the actual event. And we see this in whatever organization you're talking about. The IT people say, wow, this is going to be possibly much bigger than us. So somebody else has to own it as we get closer. The estimate we seek. If somebody came to me and said, what's it going to look like January, July 2000? I could tell you amazing historical stability over time. Since 1945, there have been roughly every year about 40 crises that generate 1,000 casualties in a year around the world. At any six-month period, you're talking about two dozen of them raging. And the United States is typically involved in two ongoing crises. And I'll give you two guesses where we're going to be involved on December 31st. Same two places we've been most of the decade. Then typically, we pick up in any six-month period two or three other ones. We call them bolts from the blue, but actually they're peaks and ongoing messes. We just get fed up with what we see, and we decide it's a crisis, and we go in to do something about it. So there's like 20 out there. We pick five. We declare those five crises because we showed up. The rest are not crises, by definition. I read it in a book somewhere. Our question is, Y2K plus millennial mania, what does that do to change the mix? Instead of the usual 20, pick five, are we going to see 25, pick five, 35, pick X, 50 that would count under normal circumstances, but maybe don't count now because we're triaging. There's only so much we can do. So do we pick five? Do we pick X? What's the number then? If we pick five, it's the same five, or is it a different five? Do they come in different order? If Saddam makes a feint towards Kuwait, do we suck the entire Defense Department to Kuwait to deal with that? And basically, I would argue, write off the rest of the world for anything that happens with Y2K. Or do we decide the rest of the world may count more than Saddam in Kuwait for a couple of weeks, given what he may or may not be able to do? Those are tough questions. They're tough to debate beforehand. They're tough to get at. And they really revolve around the issue of what's Y2K worth to you. Millennial mania, what do we mean by that? Early in the process, we went to a website, Center for Millennial Studies, Boston University, Richard Landis. You've seen him on the McLaughlin Group, CNN, Headline News. He's a great talking head. He spent his life studying the year 1000. He's a millenarian historian. Probably needs to get out more often. Got a great website. We got there early in the process, and we saw a little button in the lower left-hand corner. It said Y2K. I called him up. I said, Landis, you got it all back ass words. Your nutcases are the usual 10 to 15%. So they're heavily armed in the United States. They always are. The real story is Y2K. He says, no, 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 you got it back ass words. These people get all excited when they see those zeros in a row, and Y2K to them is rocket fuel. It proves a lot of stuff. These people are very date-focused. Oklahoma happened 2 years after Waco, to the day. The kids in Littleton shot up that place on Hitler's birthday because that had meaning to them. When they see this event coming along, they will do things that will surprise us, amaze us. They'll get amazing amounts of attention in the media. It'll be magnified. It can influence what people think and feel. Give an example, high-end kind of stuff you can find on the internet right now regarding apocalyptic millenarian views with Y2K.
The city is headed for a disaster of biblical proportion.
Well, what do you mean, biblical?
What he means is Old Testament, Mr. Yes. Mayor. Real wrath of God type stuff.
Exactly.
Fire and brimstone coming down from the skies. Rivers and seas boiling.
40 years of darkness, earthquakes, volcanoes.
The dead rising from the grave.
Human sacrifice, dogs and cats living together. Mass hysteria.
That is not a parody. I can give you websites all over the internet where you will find stuff much worse than that. I use a generic example. Why? Because I don't want to offend anybody in the audience. If I pull a real example out, it'll be somebody's faith. Okay? A lot of people believe all sorts of things because of their religious beliefs. Some of them are pretty high-end, pretty out there. We don't confront those issues every day, but some of us do, and some of us are very attracted to those notions. That's the high-end example. And the CIA told me back in May 1999 that there were 100,000 websites already out on the internet. Survivalism, Y2K, religious tinge. 100,000 websites. That's the high end. But the low end we're more interested in, this guy would describe as...
This sort of thing has cropped up before, and it has always been due to human error.
Human error, or as we like to say, ordinary people acting stupidly under stressful conditions. We actually have a $20 term for it. It's called iatrogenic. Iatrogenic means unintended side effects from treatment by a physician. My favorite example, you IT people should love it, actually happened to me one time. I woke up a Saturday morning and I said I had a problem. It's called Internet Explorer 4.0. It just ain't good enough. Can't get my direct feed, my Packer video over the internet. Just wasn't fast enough. So I acted as a physician I went to heal myself. I went to see the doctor, MSN's website. I got Internet Explorer 5.0, and by the end of the day, I couldn't boot up my computer. I ended up wiping my hard drive. I had a problem, 4.0, I fixed it. No more 4.0, no more computer either. Unintended side effects, okay? Our notion here is to define physician very broadly. It includes your Jack Van Impeys, your Jerry Falwells, who have sold, frankly, about a million videos on Y2K, giving people all sorts of advice. Your Gary Norths, your Ed Jardinis, all these people who are telling people, this may happen, you should do these things in response. Okay, and the things they're going to do in response to actual stimuli or perceived stimuli may shock us. It may be surprising what they actually end up doing. But I guarantee you, some unintended side effects will happen that won't make any sense unless you think about it in terms of how these people are approaching the problem. But rather than go on and on about millennial mania, what we do is give you four movies you can rent from Blockbuster this afternoon. Explore four different psychological aspects we think you're going to see in play in societies, not just American societies, but I'm going to give you American movies because you people don't like subtitles, frankly. Although this crowd might be actually more open to that than most. But four different movies, four psychological aspects we think you're going to see in play.
Due to mature adult content, parental discretion is advised.
The Rapture, actual tagline. Not Bambi meets Godzilla, it's an outline. Shows you how serious the movie is. Now before you get too fixated on number two, we're actually going to talk about number four, the experience of being spirited away to heaven. The parousia, the second coming of Christ. The rapture is the implied core concept of the book of Revelation. Christ comes back. Typically all the good people disappear, all the bad people suffer hell and damnation for about 7 years, and then the world is remade. The story is about a woman, telemarketer. Every day she says the same 50 words about a million times into her headphone. Okay, in the first 10 minutes of that film, probably the first most frightening 10 minutes on film I've ever seen. Because all they do is show her in her daily job saying the same 50 words again and again and again and again and again. But one point in this morning, God talks to her and says, the second coming is going to happen. Go to the desert, I will be there. She does go to the desert. Along the way, she meets David Duchovny. She has a weird experience said, okay? What's interesting about the movie is it never comes down on one side or the other. Is she insane? Or is she actually experiencing something real? The psychological aspect we like to point out is as follows. There is always a certain segment of your population in spiritual or emotional or psychological or personal trauma or crises. Some psychologists will estimate that's as much as a quarter of your population at any one time. These people are typically attracted to notions like an exogenous event coming out of nowhere and suddenly making everything better. It's a very attractive concept. Okay? This is how cults are formed. So you worry about those people being attracted to this notion and finding some sort of deliverance from their daily lives. Second movie. The Trigger Effect, 1996. Amblin Entertainment. The scenario was developed by Peter Schwartz, the famous scenario developer. Global Business Network for Steven Spielberg's company. It's about a power outage in California in the middle of summer. And you say, wow, how hard can that be? First two or three days, they're drinking liquor. They're having fun. No big whoop. And then Kyle MacLachlan and Elizabeth Shue, their kid, their three-year-old, has an ear infection. If you know anything about three-year-olds and ear infections, it is a now problem. Not a get to it sometime. It's absolutely now. So Kyle MacLachlan goes to the pharmacy. Pharmacy doesn't have electricity. No computers. No nothing. Can't help you. Come back tomorrow. Kyle says, no, today, now, right now. Pharmacist turns his back, Kyle reaches over, steals the drugs, runs out. First time he crosses the line, the whole movie goes downhill from then. At the end, people are pulling guns over things you wouldn't even believe and threaten each other with all sorts of bodily harm. And you say, where did this all go? Okay, now you look at that movie and you say, well, that's California. That explains everything. But you can talk to people in the electrical industry all over North America, and they will tell you real examples from the last two or three years that make this movie look, frankly, quite tame. Where people get frayed at the end of a 7, 8, 9, 10, 12-day process. If you look at any culture throughout history, when disaster strikes, they always behave wonderfully. It always brings them together. That's an historical fact. The problem is when the thing drags out, when the recovery experiences, when people experience a recovery in a very differentiated fashion, some recover better than others. That's when the tempers build up. That's when the battle fatigue sets in. That's when you have real anger and real problems. That's what they call the trigger effect. 1998, the X-Files movie, Fight the Future. It's a cornucopia of anti-government, conspiracy thinking, hysteria, everything you'd ever want to see. The barcodes on the backs of street signs, for example, that tell the UN troops where to set up the concentration camps when they take over the United States. But you didn't know that one. Check it out. It's on the actual backs of the street signs. There are barcodes there. The black helicopter is everything. The story I like to tell from this movie is as follows. I'm sitting in the theater with my wife behind a young couple. Okay, Martin Landau is kind of the deep throat of the movie. He's giving the core dump of all the conspiracy stuff to David Duchovny, our hero. And he says, you don't understand. At this point, the president's going to turn to the head of the FEMA, and he's going to say, declare martial law, suspend the Constitution. This is all going to happen now. I turn to my wife and I say, wow, I had no idea FEMA had that kind of power. Guy in front of me turns to his wife and says, I knew they could do that. My father-in-law works for FEMA. I figure martial law, I'm number 5, 6 on the list. I call him up that night. He says, don't worry. Rest assured, I can't get you through the FEMA. We don't have that kind of power. But I would argue if you took a poll in this country on the basis of this very popular television show, very popular movie, strings and strings of books, novels, all sorts of media that are perpetrating these kinds of concepts, that you'd find a large percentage of the population here believe that a FEMA, that a BATF, that an FBI, that an NSA, that an NRO have that kind of power. They can do whatever they want. And if they really want to take this country down, they will. And if they get an opportunity like Y2K, ooh, look out. Deep Impact, When Heaven and Earth Collide, very celestial topic. I call it the thinking man's Armageddon. It's all about the meteor hitting the Earth. The issue here of interest is the question of divided or cross loyalties as the moment of great uncertainty approaches. Okay, and you say, well, that's kind of immense. When we're talking about a real high-end scenario here. And this is frankly what we worried about with nuclear planning for years. We were worried that as you got really close to a crisis, what you'd see is people abandoning their posts. They'd say, well, the hell with this. I'm going home to kiss the wife or to hug my children or whatever. I'm out of here. Okay? This movie explores that concept in some detail. And you say, well, that's too much to even think about. And then I ask you, why have governments all over the world told their security people, their essential government services people, there's no chance in hell you're getting any vacation in December or January? Why have they told them that? Because they worry if things did start to come apart, they'd have a hard time accessing all the people they needed. There'd be Y2K sick outs. And there are people who threaten that, like pilots in various countries around the world. It's a real concern. So four movies, four psychological aspects. You say, wow, that's all Hollywood. It's all very interesting. What's it got to do with my life? I'll leave you with one last image just to intrigue you. Turns out the sun is not Y2K compliant. Solar max, the period of maximum solar flare activity, is going to come on the weekend of 1100. It's going to last through March of 2000. It comes in an 11-year cycle. Last came 1989. It's going to hit on that weekend and run roughly through the end of March 2000. I couldn't have timed it better myself. Why do we care about solar max? Frankly, the last time it came in 1989, it brought down electrical grids in some parts of Canada. That's how serious it can be. How do you disaggregate that from Y2K? If the electrical grid goes down the first week of January, how do you explain to people? It could be the sun. It's not Y2K. It's the sun. And they go, the sun? So I say, if you're looking for a sign from above, by golly, you're going to get one. And if you're willing to abuse your eyes, you can actually see it. We've done the big picture. Now we're going to do some Y2K models. Going to build you a very simple XY axis, a horizontal line. We're going to call that the what question. What is the nature of the Y2K event? The vertical axis we're going to call the so what question, or why should I care? Okay, we're going to use a medical analogy to explain the difference between those two questions, and the difference is key. We're going to talk about the vertical axis being the patient's health, overall health, and we'll say, think of the horizontal axis as the nature of the trauma or the illness in question. I'm going to give you two examples from my family's history. 1982, my 88-year-old grandfather, oldest practicing attorney in the state of Wisconsin, went into St. Mary's, Madison, Wisconsin, for a Roto-Rooter job on his prostate. He's 88 years old. If you're going to live that long, get used to the concept. He went in, they found bladder cancer, low-grade malignancy, 88 years old. They don't even bother to treat that in 88-year-old man. Why? Because they'll probably kill him in the process. They say, go home, J.E., you're going to live to 92 anyway. He didn't get home. He was so stressed out by the diagnosis, he had a stroke walking out of the hospital. And within 2 weeks, he was dead from cascading organ failure. What hit him was nothing. He should have just breezed through that. His was not a robust system. The news killed him. My daughter, 1994, 2.5 years old, Wilms tumor, diagnosed right over here in Georgetown University Hospital. Her right kidney completely gone by the time they found it, and it had already jumped to both her lungs. Doctors took us aside. They said stage 4 or 5, and I didn't have to ask what 5 was about. They said, Dr. Barnett, it's going to be chemotherapy, radiation, surgery, and get used to the concept, probably bankruptcy, probably divorce. Those are the numbers. That's what you're facing. Now, F. Scott Fitzgerald says, if you can keep two opposing concepts in your head at the same time, you're a very smart cookie. I had a hard time with what they were telling me, because what they told me right after that was, the good news is, we've never seen a kid healthier in this situation. Almost dead, never healthier in this kind of situation. I could not keep those two concepts in my brain at the same time. Obviously, I was feeling fairly stupid that afternoon. So I took them aside and I said, explain it. They said, make sure you understand this, sir. In terms of cancer, it doesn't get any worse than this. This is the most rapid aggressive cancer known to man. But we can't design a better chemotherapy patient than a 3-year-old girl with strapping good health and a positive, sunny disposition. She's absolutely perfect. We think she's going to survive the cure. And she does. She's a 7-year-old right now. She's budding horsewoman, probably the best boogie board artist on Aquidneck Island in Rhode Island right now. Okay? So you got to ask yourself, it's not just the nature of the trauma, it's how strong the system is. So we're going to build the XY axis very simply. We're going to talk, Y2K can be a whole bunch of little things, not connected, or it can be one big bad thing, all connected, interrelated, hits all at once, classic view. We can talk about networks being robust, and when we say networks, we're talking not just networks as we define them, things that move stuff, but economics as well. How does your economy handle risk? How does it process risk in its financial markets? How does your political system deal with a lot of people pissed off at the same time, needing things at the same time? How does your society deal with unscripted events? Are you Brazil, where it's Mardi Gras every other day of the week? Or are you Japan, where they have a Kobe earthquake? Or the nuclear processing plant disaster? And frankly, they have these kinds of things, and the government just sits around with its thumb up its collective butt for about 2 or 3 days going, I don't know what to do, do you? Because they don't have plans for unscripted events. They don't handle those things well. So on the other extreme, we can talk about systems being vulnerable. Okay, now if it's a lot of little things and you're strong, obviously that's your best case. That's your null hypothesis. If it's big and bad, but you're still strong, we'll call that the next best case. If it's a lot of little things and you're surprised how vulnerable you all, we call it next worst, and the obvious worst case is it's big, it's bad, and you're vulnerable. We're going to build 4 models to throw up against that. We're going to talk about a field of Y2K failures here. We're going to throw up a couple of dates along the bottom. We're going to call those actual months, those little solid lines, and these little clicked lines here, we're going to call those anal extractions. That's a technical term from the scenario building business. It means we don't really know. Okay? Good subjective time unit for Manhattan. Probably the first 4 hours, first trading day, January 3rd. A lot will be figured out then. Guy fishing for anchovies in South America has a bit more time. 4 models. First model, ice storm. It seems to hit everywhere. Okay, we're going to describe it as follows, though. A bunch of direct Y2K failures at the core, a bunch of cascading failures that come off that, say when the electricity fails, other things fail. And then you put on top the idiot factor, which always makes it better. Key question here is, what is recovery kind? Can you withstand this initial onslaught when everything seems to be falling apart, and then can you neck down the problem set quickly so you can get past this, so you don't have a revolution or whatever, a collapse of your economy? Second model, we're going to call the flood. Starts on or about 1100, builds up over time, peaks probably second or third quarter, meaning the summer. Okay? Question here is, who are those idiots who built down by the river, and why didn't they know better? The tough thing is, how do you figure out where the floodplains are beforehand? Okay? Wall Street will tell you, a lot of people on Wall Street I talk to focus in on manufacturing. They think manufacturing is a low-lying area. Why? Factory's not going to shut down at 1100. It's not going to go poof. You're going to see software glitches start to accumulate, though. You're going to see that just-in-time enterprise software system have problems. You're going to see secondary and tertiary components all of a sudden maybe not show up exactly on time. And then it's going to grind and slow down a little bit, and all of a sudden stuff's not going to be moving. You're not going to be doing business. You're not going to have an income stream. That won't happen, they hypothesize, if this model holds, until about second or third quarter. Okay? How can something like this happen? Well, look at Taiwan. They have an earthquake, and all of a sudden we discovered that 4 out of 5 motherboards in the world are produced in Taiwan. All of a sudden, Silicon Valley, the next day, if you paid attention, started revising their quarterly estimates for the next 2 or 3 quarters. Why? Because the key thing that makes computers come out isn't going to be there all of a sudden. For a while. How long? Hard to say. But an example of that kind of connectivity. Third model we're going to call hurricanes. These are sectorally limited, but not temporally limited. So it hits something like your banking and finance, and it drags out over time. So a path of destruction, like when a hurricane hits landfall. Whatever's happening there, though, won't have anything to do with what's happening in your sewer system, won't have anything to do with what's happening in your 911 system, which USA Today was warning about, front page, key article. 911 system's not ready around the country. And that might not have anything to do with some other problem in your economy. The key question here is, how do you coordinate your response over all those different issue areas so that you don't have a combined critical failure down the road brings down your systems as a whole? That's real tough consequence management. Then the fourth model we're going to call tornadoes, sectorally and temporally limited. This is the milestones, key date approach. Okay? Dates are going to come and go, and we're going to have bad things happen. This is what Gartner focuses on. This is life as we know it, sped up, a bit worse. The problem with this model today, or maybe the good part about this model today, is the key dates have come and gone without much in terms of clinical values, meaning anything beyond which your system administrator would say, take 2 aspirin, call me in the morning. Simple stuff. We've handled all these dates. First big date we'll cite, January 1st, 1999. The 365-day window is going to bump up against Y2K. Not much happened. A few bad cab rides in Singapore. Some bad visas in Sweden. April 9th, the nines problem, the 99th day of the 99th year. COBOL string is going to send us all to hell and back. Not much happened. In fact, the only key legacy we can see coming out of it is that's when you should have conceived if you wanted to have the millennial baby. My wife's due in mid-March. August 22nd, GPS rollover. All the odometers on the GPS satellites were going to hit zero again, start all over. Got nothing to do with Y2K, and yet people said, wow, this is part of the whole Y2K problem. Total fellow traveler. Nothing happened. I have Air Force people come up to me and say, you don't know how scary it was on that day. I say, show me the airplanes. Show me the dead bodies. Show me the real problems. And they come back with, you don't know how scary it was on that day. Okay? And then we were supposed to get all jacked up about September 9th, the 9th month, 9th day, 99th year. Nothing happened again. Again, we're going to have a whole bunch of these dates around 1100, a big key date when a lot of people, a lot of government agencies are going to have their control centers back up again, including the Department of Navy's leap year date. Okay? And I'm hoping to have the baby on that day. Then I have a birthday party every 4 years. That would be really good. So we're talking about all sorts of key dates spreading out over the year 2000. The question here is what constitutes learning over time? Do we care that April 9th was a complete dud? I say no. It's got nothing to do with Y2K. Do I care that October 1st was a bit of a dud? I say yeah, because that should make me feel a little bit better about 1100. Doesn't guarantee me anything on 1100, but it should make me feel a little bit better. So we're going to throw these up against our XY axis. Pretty simple. If it's a lot of little things and we're strong, we're going to call that tornadoes. If it's a big deluge and we're still strong, we're going to call that the flood. If we're surprised by the damage it creates when it hits land, we're going to call that hurricanes. And if it's the big bad situation, it's an ice storm, which you cannot escape. What I've just showed you here are what we describe as onset models. I'm now going to jump to outcome models. We're going to leave the actual event alone for a minute here. Leave it for later. So what we're going to do is throw up our weather analogies, and we're going to give you 4 different outcome scenario names that were developed by one of our workshops. So they said if it's a lot of little things and we're strong, they came up with the name run-of-the-mill scenario. They called that the run-of-the-mill scenario. No big deal, no big whoop. We're going to handle this. It's still run of the millennium. That's your null hypothesis, world's largest party and whatnot. But it's not the end of the world. If it's big and it's bad, but we're strong, they said,
I'm completely operational and all my circuits are functioning perfectly.
They compared that to hell. They said all that invisible technology jumps up and bites you in the ass one morning, but you survive. You go to the doctor, you get a tetanus shot, you pull through. It's the Nietzschean scenario. It does not kill us, it makes us stronger. And a lot of people thought that would actually be the best situation for many cultures. If it's a lot of little things, but we're surprised by how vulnerable we are. The analogy here was the Apollo 13 mission. When you had one problem in a fuel tank, a problem that was put in motion months before the launch, so that when they stirred that fuel tank, all of a sudden you had cascading system failures throughout what seemed like a really robust system, the capsule. And then you ended up with a mission kill, and frankly, almost a people kill, if you remember the movie. Okay, so all that technology, all of a sudden, an Achilles heel, and they're amazed at how vulnerable they are. And then if it's big and it's bad and you can't escape it, I got that from Redmond last Friday. Actual sound when Jackson issued his ruling coming out of Microsoft headquarters. Conventional wisdom we ran into when we started this program back in the summer of 1998. The assumption was network vulnerability going from low to high. You throw that against development level going from low to high. The assumption was this was a direct relationship. And people who focus on information warfare, cyber warfare, these kinds of issues in the Defense Department, that is a key assumption. The more developed you are, the more vulnerable you are to these kinds of attacks. So we broke down the world as follows. We said there's one ultra-modern country in terms of IT, and that's the United States. Overall, nobody even comes close. We could back down from that and talk about modern countries, your OECD level, your Japans, your Germanys, and whatnot. We could back it down even farther and talk about modernizing countries, the ones you worry about a lot more. And we developed a list we called the Big Ten plus Russia. We got the Big Ten from Jeffrey Garten, former Undersecretary of Commerce's book about 10 emerging economies going to remake the world because their share of global GDP is going to jump from like 10% to 20% over a generation. Which doesn't sound like much, but it's really quite a big deal. You scroll down the list and you say, wow, that is 3/4 of the world's landmass. That is over half the world's population. And if economists are at all right, that's about 99% of future job growth. Because that's where all the babies are happening. These are the countries that have taken on IT in a big way in only the last 10 years. For them, Y2K could be a bit of a referendum experience. U.S. isn't going to backtrack on IT, no matter how bad it is. We're way in. But China and Indonesia, you saw what Mata Yer did during the financial crisis there. New rule sets can emerge. They can decide they're going to play it differently if it's going just too fast for them. So supposedly your pre-modern IT, the rest of the world, your Haitis, your Somalis, and whatnot, had no worries. Okay, that was the conventional wisdom a year ago, Tia Tawaki. Since then, it's completely reversed itself. The concept now is that it's an inverse relationship. The more advanced you are, the least vulnerable you are. And this has all come about on the basis of remediation, or in fact, I would argue, a redefinition of what robustness is in a society. A lot of this stuff comes from the Gartner Group, the IT consulting firm. A lot of it's self-reporting. You can argue about whether the data is good. But they say your advanced countries, probably less than 25% network failures, with a third of those being more than 72 hours in length. Who do they cite with the United States as being in the best shape? We call them the Golden Quartet, Canada, UK, Australia, and the United States. I say, do you see a pattern here? Basically, Mother England and the former colonies. The other countries that get added to that group, guess what? They tend to be former British colonies. Singapore, Israel, Ireland, Andhra Pradesh in India, your virtual tigers. The countries that did well during the financial crisis in 97, 98. The countries that amazingly seemed to do well during the Chernobyl virus that hit April 26. These countries again and again that seem to show robustness when perturbations hit the international system. Why them? Why not others? Can you develop a profile as to what makes a country strong? So Gartner predicts as you go down the development level, it's actually going to get far worse. Now we apply a so what filter to this and get a curve that looks like this. We say 80% failures in Somalia. I mean, how bad can that be? How many networks do they have? Can it be any worse than 5% failure in a country with lots and lots of networks? So instead, we say, focus on your modernizing. They got just enough IT to get in trouble, maybe not just enough coping mechanisms to deal with the failures. They're on the cusp. So we throw up our XY axis again. We're going to make some predictions here about countries. We say your ultra-moderns, they're probably going to have tornadoes. Probably no big thing. Okay, the ones we worry about hurricanes, the ones who are going to be maybe surprised by the amount of damage when it hits, that's your OECD level countries that do not do the remediation. Germany is kind of blasé about this. Japan got serious about Y2K about a month ago. Till then, they spent about as much as Bank America. Okay, maybe not good. Ice storm, we worry about your modernized economies. Not that everything's going to fall apart all at once, but that it may seem in terms of their ability to process information and deal with people's pain like everything is falling all apart. So a Russia or a China, those are the ones we worry about. And then a flood is actually your pre-moderns. Doesn't mean they're not at risk. It means the risk may unfold very slowly. The example we like to cite is your sub-Saharan African countries. A certain number of them get as much as a quarter or a third of their GDP from tourism. Vast majority is ecotourism. Vast majority of the tourists are European. Vast majority of the Europeans who go down to sub-Saharan Africa to see the Lion King live do so between December and March every year. Are they going to go this year? Would you go to sub-Saharan Africa for Y2K? Probably not. Will you reschedule on January 15th if it turns out to be a dud in Europe? Travel industry says no, it doesn't work like that. People make up their minds. And the polls that we see say countries like the United States, Canada, Australia, they're staying home. Most people are going to stay in their houses. They are scared. Okay? So what happens to some of these countries in sub-Saharan Africa? You take a percent off the top? 2%? 3%? X percent? I can tell you for years of having worked with the Africa Bureau and USAID, any percent you take off the top for some of these countries is a disaster. You're talking 1 out of 4 adults HIV positive. You're talking about life expectancy dropping from the high 50s to the low 30s in the next 12 years. So that's real pain that may happen no matter what happens with Y2K. That may already be in the works. The M-curve of influence, our most controversial concept, counterintuitive argument. We run into this perspective all the time. You're going to have to excuse our kind of vague terms on some of these left-hand things, but we'll be honest, we just don't know what they are. But what we run into all the time is with CEOs and a lot of people who are heads of agencies and heads of organizations, governments, is that they look at Y2K and they say, this thing's going to come and go very quickly. It's going to asymptotically rise last few weeks in 99, and then it's going to go away. It's going to be all done probably by January 15th. It's one model, okay? And it may be the right model, but it may not be the right model. A lot of people are predicting this thing's going to be a lot longer. It won't be so neatly packaged like that. We say if you're talking about elite influence over mass events, the curve is actually going to look like this, hence the name. We say your influence to shape mass events is going to be at its peak, both before and after the onset. But when the onset actually happens, people will tune you out. World's largest party, they will have made up their minds about Y2K. They'll have Y2K fatigue. They won't trust you. If you start coming clean at the last moment, oh, by the way, we think it's going to be a lot worse than we've been telling you for the last 18 months. Get ready. Okay? You're starting to see some of that stuff now. We've been assured by our government again and again and again. All of a sudden, all these little reports are coming out. 911 systems, nonprofit medical centers. A lot of places that all of a sudden aren't going to be as good. That news is coming out. That's starting to chip away at people's confidence. How much? Probably not that much in this country. But other places, we worry more. So we say you can schedule and shape the buildup. The best you can do is slow down the sense of abnormal time as this thing kicks in. And then as the problem set emerges, that's when you can define and execute exit strategies. Why do we focus on the first hump? Going to make a conceptual argument. Again, another vague term here. We're going to talk about two social dynamics going on in a society. And we believe this is a rough model for how things happen whenever you have a big crisis coming down the pike. Okay, you got two different dynamics going on. The first one we're going to call the rise of awareness in the public transcript. People become aware of the problem. They start getting official truths. What it's going to be like, what it's going to feel like, what's going to happen, what's possible. Okay? Countering that is a second dynamic, which we're going to call the rise of fear and the private transcript. Let me give you an example of the difference between a public and private transcript. Coca-Cola, year-end report last year, assured all its investors. I got the report on my desk back in my office. We are taking care of the Y2K problem. We're going to spend $160 million. Good stuff. Don't worry about it. Okay, what they didn't tell you, which ABC Peter Jennings reported this spring, is that they are spending $160 million. $80 million to remediate, $80 million to stockpile sugar all over the world. That's a lot of sugar cubes. Okay? An example on an individual basis between a public and a private transcript. Those kids in Littleton had a private public transcript. It was called go to school, go to the prom, look normal, sign up for college. Their private transcript was plot for a year to kill everybody in the high school. Until their private transcript emerged on Hitler's birthday this year, their public transcript was all we knew, and that was all that we could understand. But when the private transcript emerged one day, boom, it became suddenly incredibly relevant. Okay? When this process overwhelms this process, we hypothesize what we call a trigger zone, when things can unravel. That's what you have to guard against. That's what you have to make sure in any society doesn't happen. We think it's preventable. Okay? So we talk about the United States, a great job by Koskinen and company, kind of bored us to death at this point. We would argue fear in a private transcript probably going to be pretty muted. Probably relegated to the usual 10 or 15% in our population. They're kind of weird anyway. And I say thank God we give them every opportunity to own as many assault rifles and weapons as possible. So that when they get pissed off and angry at the world, they can go everywhere and shoot everything up. So we worry about a trigger zone, but we think it's going to be kind of muted probably Thanksgiving and beyond. What would a trigger zone look like? Well, frankly, it would almost look like right now, where you have a mass shooting every other day. Honolulu, Seattle. I mean, we got so many names for them, we can't, the list is unbelievable this year. Imagine a whole bunch of those, day in and day out, last couple weeks of December, because people think it's the end of the world. What would that do to people's sense of the future? I know after Littleton, I walked into a McDonald's the next day with my kids, and I scanned the exits the entire time we were in there with our Happy Meals, thinking what I would do if somebody walked in. Okay, I put that thought out of my mind about 24 hours later. But it gets you like that. It grabs you. Rest of the world, though, what you should be concerned about, we say the awareness of public transcript, very muted. And when you get nearer to the end of the process, all you can really do at the end, the only thing you really have that's your own, is your ability to freak out. So we worry about a real panic zone, a real trigger zone. Second curve, and this is where we start hypothesizing. We don't know if Sally has one hump or two, whether she's a Bactrian or a dromedary. We're going to suppose, for the issues of what-ifing, that this second hump has meaning. The reason why, we say, is you look to Marcosio and the people at Gartner Group, which predict what will actually happen with Y2K. They say in terms of direct failures, 5% happen over the first half of 99, 25% happen over the second half of 99. Small core group, but it actually is the highest frequency per day, happens around the 1100 rollover. Then lo and behold, 45% is still going to happen over the year 2000, and a tail of 15% over the year 2001. You draw that curve, and it looks pretty different. Okay? So if you got this kind of perspective, hey, it's going to come, it's going to go, and you're planning your resources like that, you may run into a real problem, because the halfway mark may not be until the end of March in terms of failures. And the question is, what have you spent already? What have you got left over to deal with the problem set? So whether this looks like tornadoes, whether it looks like hurricanes, whether we're talking an ice storm or the flood in Algene, frankly, all those are going to happen. These are ideal types. No one thing is going to happen. And it's going to be an argument historians are going to have for years as to what models hold. But it all depends on the interconnectivity of the failures. And that's what gets you to the people factor, or what we call scenario dynamics. So to wrap this up, we're going to say elite influence over mass events, before and after is the peak. Your influence is at its nadir when it really hits. That's a warning we give people. We're going to throw over Gartner's predictions of direct failures to give you a sense of the difference here. And our argument, in a nutshell, is do your prep work, ride out the wave. Do not jump through your rear end trying to solve everything that weekend, because you'll probably have the least amount of influence and you'll waste a lot of resources. Plus, you may panic people by trying to do a lot of stuff that doesn't seem to have any good. When this problem set starts to emerge and this tail gets big and fat, that's when you can go out and aggressively triage to drive down the failure impact rate. That is very tough political advice, because governors are going to feel pressure if there are problems in their states to do something and do it really fast to show that they're on top of it. Otherwise, you may find yourself voted out next time or run out much sooner than that. So we talked about before and after models, giving you a sense of some of the dynamics we think in terms of how the elites and masses will come together and work this problem set. Now we're going to look at the actual event itself. We're going to break down our M curve into the following six categories, six phases. We're going to talk about a mania phase, which I would argue we're already in the United States to a certain extent, but it's relegated to a certain segment of our population. And this argument happens largely on the internet. Okay? As we get closer, it's going to be a different phase. People are going to act differently the last couple weeks. I bought 50 gallons of water about 2 weeks ago. I buy them in big chunks anyway because we got used to drinking bottled water with my daughter and her chemotherapy. But when I decided I was going to go to BJ's and get my usual amount, I said, wow, I was going to run out about late December. And I started to think, well, I'm not that concerned about it, but what if all of a sudden I could not get any water at BJ's in late December? And I'll tell you, hurricane starts in the Caribbean. I can't buy any water in Aquidneck Island. And it won't hit for 10 days. But that's the kind of dynamic you run into again and again. Are you being sensible or are you crossing the line? At some point, this baby's got to hit. And then again, we're into the hypotheses here. It's got to unfold. It's got to get as bad as it's going to get at some point. And then it's got to be done. Either it poops out, runs out of steam. We declare it's over. We invent a new crisis. We have a splendid little war, whatever. There are all sets of answers you can throw at the problem. So we take that six phases. And what we do is develop a composite scenario that's on the stressing side here, okay? That's what we're interested in. People say, wow, you're fear-mongering. I say, if not us, a war college, political scientists, then who? If not now, would you prefer us to do it afterwards? So what we come up with is our black box model. We call it scenario dynamics grid. We're going to build it as follows. I'm going to give you four rows here, break down the problem into four sets. Networks, anything that moves anything. Bytes, electricity, information, people. Processes things, medical emergencies, moves stuff. Business, anything from retail, manufacturing, banking, and finance. Social, anything from face-to-face to the internet to Peter Jennings to John Paul, the whole shebang. Governance, internal and external security issues. And frankly, a focus on internal security in most countries. Because if Y2K is bad, it's a localizing effect. Okay, it cuts us off from one another. I'm going to give you six phases here. We already went over them. Mania countdown, onset, unfolding, peak, and exit. And I'm going to draw a big red line right here. And I'm going to say, first three columns we think are in the works. We think we have strong indications for all of those. That's why a lot of people in the intelligence community are interested in this model as a way of thinking about system perturbations in general. Okay. Beyond that, though, we're into educated speculation land. We're asked to imagine what it would be like. Okay. And we think it's better to know beforehand what it could be like, because then you're not surprised, and you can handle whatever it is. That's why the doctors should tell you that stuff before they start cutting you open. Okay? So we say, think of this as a smorgasbord. Every country's coming to this buffet table. Who tries what dishes in what combinations? I can't tell you in advance. I can just tell you that all things are possible. I don't think all of it's going to happen anywhere. I think all sorts of combinations are going to happen somewhere, if it turns out to be significant. We're going to start with networks. We're going to go from left to right. Mania phase, key dynamic, not surprising, stockpiling. That is a middle class and above phenomenon. Why? You need disposable income. We say, watch, as we go from mania to countdown, that's what these red boxes are going to be. Canaries in the coal mine, signposts that you're going from one phase to the next. The key indicator as we go from mania to countdown, the thing to watch, are the most vulnerable. That's going to be your urban poor. Your rural poor can typically take care of themselves when they have this kind of problem set. Or as my mom likes to say back in Basketball, Wisconsin, we run out of food, I'll send your father out with a Buick, he gets a deer every year anyway. Can't do that in Manhattan. Okay? When they see people stockpiling, they're going to get nervous. Countdown, two-headed phenomenon, getting there and getting it there. Getting there is our prediction. You're going to see a higher than average use of transportation networks globally in the last few weeks up to the actual event. Not on the rollover. That's going to be a bit of a dead zone. But you're going to see people moving around a little bit higher, or you should pay attention to that a little bit more. You're going to have rich people going to exotic locations, experience millennium rollover date, perhaps several times, to bring meaning to their otherwise vacuous existences. You're going to see religious people going to religious meccas around the world. Cairo expects a lot of people. They're going to have an all-night opera at the pyramids. If I'm the Muslim Brotherhood, I got a target-rich environment. I got a whole bunch of tourists. I got everybody watching in the middle of nowhere. I couldn't get more excited. Okay? Israel, Jerusalem, expects to quadruple Israel's entire population that weekend in Jerusalem alone. Israel's about 5 million people. They're expecting maybe 20 million people in Jerusalem. That's stress. Okay, Rome expects 15 to 20 million people. The mall here in Washington expects some big, big number. They're going to have a big party. Times Square expects big, big numbers. Wherever you're talking about, you're going to have that. You may see urban areas where people go to rural areas, take care of mom and dad, take care of kids, take care of whatever because they're scared. You may see nutcases run to the hills of West Virginia or Arizona where they bought land and they have their little dog shelters and they're going to ride it all out with their cans of Spam. Okay? But you may see higher than average movement. Getting it there is the other phenomenon. That's the topping off phenomenon connected with stockpiling. In the United States, you've been told everybody should have their gas tank full December 31st. The problem is we all drive our cars every day of the week. The only way we can have our gas tanks full is if we all go to the gas tanks. Gas stations last 2-3 days of the year. And guess what? If we all try to do that, it's not physically possible. Our just-in-time distribution system, it does not allow everybody to have gas tank full at the same time. And if we try, you're going to have gas lines. I guarantee it. And if you have gas lines, you're going to have CNN there in about 15 minutes. And then George W. Bush is going to open his mouth, start saying all sorts of things. Then there's going to be a shot of the White House, and Gore's not going to be anywhere, and there's going to be no comment, and there's going to be political football, and everything's going to unravel right then. Okay? They've since backed off. Now they say have your gas tank half full. Very good. Going from countdown to onset, we say watch for the going offline phenomenon. France has said it's willing to take off all its electricity from the nuclear power grid if they have any concerns at the last minute, which would be a very bold thing for them to do because it's about 80% of their electricity. Okay, in the United States, you've seen these warnings. Please do not overwhelm networks. FCC, I got it from AT&T in the mail. Don't use your telephone. Don't use your modem if you're not paying attention. You've gotten these messages. On December 31st, January 1st, because they fear the Mother's Day effect times 100. Everybody picks up the phone at 12:01 to wish mom a happy millennium, make sure she's okay. Problem is, if you all pick up the phone at the same time, public switch network is going to drop. It's not built for all of us to call mom at the same time. And if it does, everybody's going to scream into the phone simultaneously, Mom! And then we're going to get freaked out a little bit on that basis. And maybe we all try to go to the internet, make sure it's all working. Okay? If we all get into the internet at the same time, you can bring the internet down if you do it just right. If you don't believe that's possible, Victoria's Secret almost did it with a webcast. Women walking around in their underwear. one afternoon almost brought down the internet. We say there may be some system overloads. Electrical people predict that there will be actually fairly low usage levels because a lot of industry is going to go offline as part of their boundary plans. They're going to shut down December 31st, come back on January 3rd. It may actually obviate some of the ups and downs that we have with people. That would be a good thing. But there will be other system overloads, ER rooms, you know, all the stuff that typically happens when you have a lot of stuff going on. We worry about, and this is where we get into the speculation, going from onset to unfolding, we say watch for the blackouts. The delivery of electricity, that's the key thing. That's an easy, obvious indicator to track. That's why New Zealand, everybody's going to be watching New Zealand when it hits there. And New Zealand knows it. Problem is, New Zealand has a horrible record with electricity. They had an outage in Auckland one time, it lasted 6 weeks. Utter disaster. Okay, so I wish we could have figured out to move somebody else into that area. Unfolding, we say you may experience a rationing dynamic. You may see restrictions to access to mass transit, restrictions to access to major urban areas, restrictions to access to cross borders. Okay, in the United States, this would be very traumatic. In most countries of the world, you have this stuff happening all the time. Santiago, Chile, you have to have a certain sticker on your car to be able to drive into the capital on certain days because of the smog factor. But I know people from Santiago, Chile who tell you the way you get around it is you own several cars, you put a different sticker on every car, they're all stinky gas-producing gas guzzlers, and you just, you know, that's your workaround for the problem set, okay? But you may see that kind of rationing. Going from unfolding to peak, we say watch for the traffic jams. Here we focus in on your megaports. There are about 10, 12 megaports around the world that basically move about 95% of all shipping. Rotterdam in Northern Europe. There's a couple in Northeast Asia. We got a couple on the East Coast, like one or two on the West Coast. These are very important ports. They're huge. They're jurisdictional nightmares, overlapping stuff, all sorts of embedded chips, all sorts of legacy software systems. No one's actually totally in control. That's a real big concern because that can slow stuff up in that flood model. Okay? These two boxes right here, these are crucial. We call these critical pathway determinants. If it's going to be a real crisis, this stuff's going to happen. If it's not going to happen, then we're probably more on the other side of the equation. Less a real crisis actually triggered by Y2K and more a virtual crisis triggered by ourselves. And that's what people worry about. But let's assume it's going to be real, and we continue. Networks, peak situation, have versus have not, de facto. Not everybody will have the same problem set. Not everybody will remediate in the same way. Not everybody will have the same disposable income levels to deal with shortages. Not everybody will stockpile in the same way. Not everybody will have the same good government to deal with problem sets. Okay? So it's a basic have versus have not. It may be urban versus rural, maybe north versus south. I like to say it'll be growing season in South America. It'll be eating season in North America. Okay, now the fruits and vegetables don't come easily. Guess who has to pay more? Quickly. To go from peak to exit, and the exit we're going to define as metropolis save, meaning if you keep the major urban areas okay, countryside probably takes care of itself, you may have to see the arising of network leviathans. Vague term. Okay, what do we mean by a network leviathan? Look at Turkey after the earthquake. Recovery, first 3 or 4 days, sucked. Nothing was moving. Real disaster. People got pissed off. Government responded. What did they do? They sent in the army. All of a sudden, stuff started to move. Why? Because the army in most cultures is an organization that can make stuff move when nothing else is moving. They specialize in moving under austere conditions called war. So you may have to see the insertion of armies, militaries, and certain recoveries if this turned out to be significant. How comfortable can you get with that? What dangers arise from that? Okay, so we talk about the possibility of new fault lines coming out of this situation. Good example of a fault line, again, go to Turkey, certain cities. You can walk down a street, and on the left side, you're going to see buildings still standing where rich people live, built by good contractors up to code. On the other side of the street, you're going to see rubble where poor people used to live, built by rat bastards who didn't believe in building up to code. That street is a fault line, a network fault line between good and bad. We used to call it the good side of the tracks and the bad side of the tracks. That's a fault line, though, that Turkey's going to deal with for years, politically, socially, economically. There'll be a lot of hell to pay on that one. Business mania, taking options is a polite phrase for preparing to screw over your long-term business partners behind their backs. Okay, they call it pulling the trigger. You've been my vendor for many, many years on a particularly important critical component. I don't think you're up to snuff. I have great suspicions about you. As the date comes close, I secretly negotiate with you to junk you out at the last minute and bring you in. And at some point, I have to pull the trigger because I have to get you in position so I'm comfortable that your loss won't significantly impact my just-in-time distribution and supply system. Okay? The dynamic to watch as we go from mania to countdown is what we call leper lists. All sorts of leper lists. E&E should be very familiar with the leper list right now. There's a very key one. It's called Moldova, Belarus, Russia, and Ukraine. The leper list is anybody who's concerned about living there as a U.S. Embassy employee or whatever gets to leave on the government's dole at like $5,000-$10,000 a crack. That's a huge leper list. That says, we're with you, sorta. Okay? Wall Street has lots of leper lists, I would argue. They're carried around in the front pockets of a lot of business people. And they're not made public, but they will be acted on. Flight to quality during countdown. This has been a quiet summer in terms of volume. Not in terms of volatility, but in terms of volume on the U.S. stock market. It's predicted to be a rather quiet fourth quarter, in terms of volume. That's different from volatility, volume. They're saying a lot of people are going to sit out Y2K. A lot of investors, a lot of traders say that a lot of ordinary investors have decided to kind of get their things in order and then kind of ride this one out and see what happens on the far side. Already there's a bit of a shortage in the corporate bond market, debt for private corporations. That's why all the anything.coms are rushing to get their IPOs out the door, their initial public offerings, because they're worried as the year progresses there's going to be less and less money there. So I say, thank God Martha Stewart got her billion when she could, because it may not be there in a couple weeks. My favorite example of flight to quality, I gave this speech in the Pentagon in the summer. Air Force Colonel came up to me afterwards and said, Dr. Barnett, what are you going to do with your 401k? I get this question a lot. I'm like financial advisor, all sorts of people. I said, I'm going to leave it on the S&P 500 index. Why? I've done that throughout the entire 90s. I don't need the money for 38, 40 years. I plan to live to be 120. I don't need it for a long time. I say, let it ride, baby. It's been very, very good to me. He says, that's an interesting theory. He says, sometime mid-November, I'm going to take all my money out of the stock market. I said, how much you got in? He goes, I'm 100% vested. I said, you're taking it all out? He goes, I got to get it out before all those crazy people start doing stupid stuff with their money. So I look at him and I said, you're going to be one of the first? Going from countdown to onset, we say watch for the cash on hand issue. Alan Greenspan, Mr. Do Anything on a Dare, Mr. Wildhair. December 1998, decided to expand the U.S. money supply by 33%. That is unbelievable. Pumped an extra $50 billion. He announced it in December 1998, because if he announced it in December 1999, it would have been the world's largest bank run. And guess what? It takes a long time to print $50 billion. And they had real arguments. Should we print 20s or 100s? You know anything about people who carry cash around? They carry 100s. Nobody likes to go to the ATM and get like $1,000 in 20s, because that thing just goes, and it can't get it out. Okay? Cash on hand, another issue, more of interest to you guys. A lot of countries around the world don't print their own currency. Surprisingly, other countries print it for them. So if there's a little bit of a push at the end of the year, guess who's first in line? But a lot of cultures, you know, when you get scared, you turn cash into gold or you turn it into a cow because it's mobile and you can cut it up later if you need it. You know, every culture has their own definition of what's a good, transferable, tangible asset. Onset, we say watch for a dead zone, financial markets, in terms of retail as well. A lot of cultures have an end of the year celebration. Typically, they figure out a way to make it a gift-giving thing. Some at the end of the year, some at the beginning of the year. But you got Ramadan, you got all sorts of stuff going on all over the world. It's a typical human thing. Supermarkets around the world tend to move transactions away from the 1-1 deadline every year for accounting reasons. They're going to do it this year with a vengeance. It's going to be a real serious dead zone. You're going to see markets around the world preemptively, governments declaring banking holidays, January 3rd, January 4th, January whatever. They're already starting to do that. Some are coming out and saying, well, we've decided our people need an extra day to rest after a tumultuous weekend of much partying. Virgin Airlines, that was my favorite, Richard Branson, he got up and he said, you know, we've always cared about our people. We always gave them off Christmas. This year we care even more. Bit of a dead zone. At some point you got to come back online though, and when you do, you're going to have market quakes. That's the idea to watch for. It doesn't mean it's got to happen, but you watch for it. A market quake can be real movement of money in response to all sorts of imaginary things, which is life as we know it. Or it can be something as simple as, say the Nikkei goes down in Japan for 4 or 5 hours on January 3rd for electrical reasons. It happens. It happens all the time. We don't freak out about it because we just say, well, that happens. New York Stock Exchange has gone down because a rat chewed through an electrical wire. It happens all the time, but it doesn't have meaning outside of a special time like this. any time in this country, 2% of all ATMs are down, out of service. Now, how many of you walk up to that and go, Teotihuacan, end of the world, start shooting up your neighbor, going home, you know, raping and pillaging on that basis? No, we say that's life. You walk away and you say, damn, I'll go to the next one. But guess what? Banks in this country are really concerned about ATMs, any of them being down on January 1st. Because somebody sees that, and all of a sudden it has different meaning for them. They go, wow, I never noticed that before. All of a sudden there's a long line there. I mean, you're driving down the street and you see a long line at the ATM, and you're like, what's that all about? I mean, you start to wonder. On to the speculation. We get it unfolding. We're talking about islanding or fortressing. That's the idea of coming through on the threats he made back here. You may, kind of like a medieval castle, you bring up the drawbridge. Some vendors and suppliers you bring inside. The rest you say, see you on the other side. Too bad. Another version of this would be to neck down your production to something very simple. There's one of the big three automakers who says, if they have problems, they're going to basically only produce SUVs in the year 2000. They have a plan to neck down production globally to just SUVs because they think they'll be very popular and because they have the highest profit margin. So if you can't produce all of it, produce some of it. It's certainly something you can sell. Going from unfolding to peak, we say watch for the personal GDP issue. If I take $500 out to deal with this problem, and I probably will, as long as I got $500 and there's problems, I'm fine. When I get to the zero mark and I can't get money, all of a sudden my decision making goes out the window. Same for companies. If they set aside $1 million to deal with this problem, they're good as long as they're working through the million. When the million goes away, boom, they're in a different world all of a sudden. A peak situation would be a cash economy, or as I like to say, I travel the world over with a credit card, piece of plastic, 16 numbers and my name on it. I show it to anybody, and they give me whatever I ask for. You take that card away from me, all of a sudden trust evaporates. Credit evaporates. I don't go anywhere fast. Okay, it would look like 1930s America all of a sudden if that happened. Frankly, it would look like Russia, 1990s. They manage just fine. It all depends on what you can handle and what you're used to. A peak situation, or to go from a peak situation to the exit point, which we're defined as the winner's crown, meaning those in your economy that do well during this period of economic turbulence are identified and emulated. This happens on Wall Street about every 7-8 years. You crown the new giants. You may have to engage in SME triage, small and medium enterprise triage. Predictions are, if this is a big problem economically, Y2K, the first ones that are going to drop are going to be your small and medium enterprises. In an advanced economy, that's like 90% of your firms, half your employables. Even in your less advanced economies, it's a lot of people. And all of a sudden, you got unemployment in a way you didn't have, maybe. So we talk about new rules coming out of this. Social mania phase. We talk about the truth is out there phenomenon. People mistrusting what they hear from the government. You get a lot of this. My favorite quote after the Japanese nuclear processing plant disaster, they talked to an average Japanese guy. And he gave a Japanese variant on how do you know when the Japanese government is lying? He said, well, basically when their lips are moving. Okay? That's in Japan, where they basically worship authority. That's how far they've come with some of these disasters. They're getting pretty cynical. That is the phenomenon you have to watch. So the rumor mills are big deals. Countries where they distrust official truths. A China, a Russia. Countdown, we talk about information overload. Peter Jennings in the United States is going to go on for 25 hours straight. How do I know? They called me up. They asked me where to put the cameras around the world. I said, do I get a cut from this kind of advice? Or? So they're going to be on there, storm coverage, like when you have a first snowflake in Washington, and they all run out, take a picture of it. Then they're going to see a naked man running down the street going, the end is near, and they're going to take a big shot of him, go ask him a few questions, get his philosophy on life. Then they'll have to analyze it. Okay, countdown to onset. Watch for the final solutions. My favorite example is that Furrows fellow walking into Los Angeles, Jewish Community Center, shooting up everybody he could find. He had a final solution. He's fairly explicit about it. It's called kill all the Jews before the end of the millennium. And his real advice is get the young ones if you can. If you can get the young ones, that's the best thing. And do it on television if you can to get other people to do the same thing. He had a final solution. He activated it. And he wants people to follow his example. Okay, if you see people doing weird things at the end of the year, they may be engaging in final solutions. It may make no sense to you unless you realize they have a very different take on this whole 12/31/99 thing. And it may be very frightening, and it may be magnified socially. Onset, all our experts said, don't get between people, no matter what culture you're talking about around the world, get between people and their will to party, because you'll just piss them off, and you'll create more problems than it's worth. Going from onset to unfolding, we say watch for the panic release. In Jerusalem, around the Mount of Olives, all the apartments are rented through the end of this year. Not into next year, just through the end of this year. Evangelicals in serious numbers are in that country. And they have the typical MO. Their leader is Christ. He needs to meet an Antichrist on December 31st, 1999. If he does, the Antichrist will kill him. Then the leaders and the followers will be involved in all sorts of bloodshed. The throne of David will be reconstituted. There's one of the beliefs. It just so happens where they want to put the throne of David is right where Islam has one of its most sacred mosques. Okay, and they talk openly, some of them, about, well, maybe it needs to be blown up. Maybe God needs a little help here. And guess what? If some of that kind of things happen, you're talking about real difficulties for the Middle East peace program. Real difficulties. So my bold prediction is there will be many Jesus Christs walking the street of Jerusalem January 1st. I, as a Christian, will not recognize any of them. But some people will. And there'll be panic on that basis. Unfolding, we talk about a iatrogenic zone, people doing stupid things, hurting themselves. So we say watch for the battle fatigue as you go to the peak situation. In the peak situation, we're going to talk scapegoating. We still do human sacrifice in many parts of this world. In Indonesia, when they had the financial meltdown, within weeks, they were hunting for black ninja witches in rural mountain villages. Why? Because when they have unexplained bad things in Indonesia, they go get themselves a ninja witch and they kill it. And then they feel better about life. In the United States, we have a more high-tech version. We call them Senate hearings. But wherever you're talking about, there are social identifiable groups typically picked on. You're Chinese in Indonesia. You're Jews in certain parts of Eastern Europe and Russia. They're always to blame. Okay? So we talk about going from peak to exit, which we'll define as the worst is over, the perception among the mass of the population that the worst is over. You may have to show that the guilty will pay. The lawyers will have to get them, or ministers will resign like they did in certain Central American countries after Mitch hit. Really, you know, complicated our efforts when aid and others went down there to help rebuild after the disaster with the Mitch. They found out a lot of ministers had resigned to kind of show their how they felt the pain of the people, and then you had new people in there. It was complicated. It actually made it worse. Okay? So you may have to show that a guilty will pay. My favorite example is this is you could always just point to your vice premier and say, it's all his fault. Okay? Not only that, I got pictures of him seducing young boys. He's going on trial this afternoon, don't worry, he's going to be put in jail for the rest of his life. If you don't believe that can happen, you should go to see the former vice premier of Malaysia. I think his visiting hours are every other week. Because after they had the 1997 meltdown, all of a sudden he was guilty of everything. And he was put in jail. So we talk about the possibility of a new face coming out of this. A lot of revolutionary movements are born out of adversity, disasters. Tupac Amaru in Peru, the people who took over the Japanese embassy in January 1997, they were born in an earthquake in a remote region in Peru. Help never came. They decided they had an answer. It was called Tupac Amaru. And years later, they had quite a big body count. Credibility gap, government in the mania phase. You know anything about the Y2K Pentagon Papers, Jim Lord? Okay? Somebody got a hold of some early planning documents, misread them, started telling everybody it was a prediction on the part of the Department of Navy that New York City was going to enter total chaos on December 31st. No such thing. It's just a planning document where they said, we're going to put a zero for every city in the country unless you can go prove to us by talking to the people there that they're not going to have a problem. This guy got a hold of the early copy of the document before they bothered to call anybody in New York. And guess what? He saw a whole bunch of zeros there. And he said, Navy predicts chaos in New York. Navy didn't predict any such thing. That was just a crisis management planning document. That shows you the credibility gap. That's the importance of the Y2K and you educational efforts. Authority on tap when you get close to the countdown. Our advice is don't introduce any new rules, any new rulers, any new anything. Because you would just scare people and piss them off. They'll think that the end game is starting. One of the rumors on the internet, whether you're aware of this or not, is that martial law is set for the District of Columbia December 15th. It's a done deal. Martial law is coming. And in some quarters, it's a well-known fact that I'm actually in charge of it. Jack Anderson wrote an article in early May identifying Tom Barnett as the head of a super-secret organization within the military, secretly retaining the military, in effect, to create a complex, sophisticated social response network, which sounded an awful lot like martial law once Y2K chaos hit. I showed the article to my wife. She said, my God, if you can manage that all from your laptop, why can't you take out the garbage on Tuesday like I asked? Going from countdown to onset, we say watch for the first strike potential. These are individuals doing something to mark the occasion, just to tell the world that there's something about the status quo they don't like and they want to change. They're not going to take it anymore. Our favorite example, Norton antivirus people are predicting that there may be as many as 200,000 viruses released that weekend. Why? Because they can. Because they just want to show they can. Because it's a good time. If you go to hacker websites right now, chat rooms, they talk about it quite openly. 200,000 viruses. Let's say they're 10 times overhyping that. Let's say there's only going to be 20,000 viruses. Let's say 80% of them are crap. Don't do anything. Let's say only 4,000 of them are real. Guess what? That would be more computer attacks on the internet in one weekend than we've ever had in a year globally, according to Carnegie Mellon. Okay? Keeping up appearances during the onset, all our experts said, if you do normal things around 1100, make sure you do them that weekend. So I say, if the president of your country walks out of the presidential palace onto the plaza, eats a tortilla, blesses the people, wishes them a happy new year, make sure he's there on time, make sure the tortilla is hot and tasty, make sure he gets it down and staggers off alive. Because if anything happens to that guy, you may see a segment of your population saying, oh, it started. Good example, John Paul, probably give a mass on December 31st. You've seen him lately, you know that is one sick guy, health-wise. Speaking as a Catholic here. Okay? He's probably going to do a mass watched by about 2 or maybe even 3 billion people. Okay? If he were to have a heart attack or something, if he staggered, if he looked especially weak, if he stumbled and fell down, there would be people around the world who would say, some, wow, this has begun. The Antichrist is here. Something's happening. I'm scared. This is a sign. So you got to watch and take care of those situations. Onset to unfolding, we say watch for opportunists who may take advantage of what is perceived to be Y2K chaos. I'm in London giving this brief to the head of U.S. Naval Forces Europe. London Times, top story that day. Rebel IRA faction plans to blow up Millennium Dome on December 31st to take advantage of Y2K chaos. Couldn't have picked a better example. Backlash during the unfolding situation. Guess what? You take this laptop, you put it in many cultures all around the world, and people look at it and it just screams American at them. It screams our technology, our system, our way of thinking, our problem. If we come through this problem well and they do not, guess what they'll think? They'll think we knew the answer all along. Bill Gates always had the answer. That's a very popular theory. A lot of people discuss it on the internet. So if we held on them, obviously it was a plot. It was a conspiracy. And guess what? They may be mad. And when they're mad, they may decide to show how mad they are. They may show it against American citizens abroad, against American companies, against American symbols. That's a real issue. Going from unfolding to peak, we say watch for the answer man. Speaking as a guy who works with the military all my life, all my adult life, this guy tends to be ex-military. Okay, he stands up in the middle of chaos and he says, I can take care of all this chaos and uncertainty. Just give me a little bit of your political freedoms, a little bit of your civil liberties. I only need them for a short period of time, and then everything will be better. And historically, we know this guy tends to hold on to him for about 35, 36 years until the rat bastard finally dies in his hospital bed and the country is plunged into chaos. Peak situation, mobilization capacity, it all comes down to what the government can handle. Hurricane Andrew in the United States and Florida, it was amazing what the U.S. could muster. You talk to experts on local police around the world, they will tell you, underfunded, underfed, underage, under everything. A very thin blue line, a stiff breeze takes them out. Peak situation going to an exit point, which we'll call the legal deconstruction. In this country, it'll be when the lawyers start talking faster than I am right now. You may see governments engage in killer applications. Very bold acts to show that they're still in control despite all that stuff possibly happening. What's a killer application? A benign example could be Tony Blair giving a Churchillian-like speech over the BBC. The Brits go, ooh, we can handle this. We've been through a lot. It could be martial law. It could be taking out your political opposition. It could be ethnic cleansing, because you know those people are responsible for all your problems. So we talk about the possibility of new rulers coming out of this. Again, this is the black box model. You enter here, you exit there. In terms of real triggers, real crisis triggers, we focus on these four boxes right here. But in terms of a potential virtual crisis, stuff we do to ourselves, or stuff we think you're going to see all over the internet, which we think is a precursor of the future in many ways, we say it's the whole shebang. All these things are possible. We are ripe for this kind of stuff. Okay, economically, socially, and a lot of different levels. And sometimes Americans, sometimes humanity in general, just like to pick at that scab. They want to get it over with if they know something bad's going to happen. A couple of words on sync strategies. We're just going to give you a sense of what we think the military could be doing around the world during this whole situation. Okay, 12 missions we think they will be engaged in, if it turns out to be as we predict. We're going to show you this slide again. I'm just going to throw up 12 missions quickly. Mania and countdown, we're talking about intel prep of the battlefield. That's a fancy way of saying knowing what may happen, figuring it out. Okay, if you're talking about failures during the onset, you may see them engage in logistic or network tiger teams, special teams that go into countries where they have bases to deal with critical node failures to make sure the electricity is still going into Aviano Air Force base in Italy or something like that. Okay, and they may be much more concerned about that than the chaos going on around them, if there is such chaos. And they may look very insensitive doing that. But their argument is that's what they got to take care of first. If you got this kind of problems going on, you're going to see relief operations in terms of network failures. So we're talking freedom of navigation or escort operations, because it's not enough just to secure the nodes in relief operations. You got to secure the transit between the nodes. We learned that in Somalia, because it's between the nodes where you have your bandits or your technicals or your pirates or your occasional longshoremen. Stuff falls off the backs of trucks, never seems to get there. Business, big breakdowns. We're talking about complex humanitarian emergencies like a Haiti or Somalia. Social, will to party, show of force may be an issue. That is putting troops out there to show people nothing's going to happen. It's like when we put National Guard out on the street after a hurricane or something like that. Don't even think about looting is what it says. Don't even think about messing around. Guys are out there with guns. Nothing's going to happen, so forget about it. People hurting themselves, you may have to engage in medical support. Scapegoating, ethnic cleansing is just scapegoating writ large. East Timor is just scapegoating writ large. Kosovo, scapegoating writ large. That's your classic UN stuff. Governance during the mania phase, community outreach to make sure the bases aren't overwhelmed by people freaking out. Want to get on the base, they say, oh, everything's good inside there. Mill programs, like setting up that special thing we're going to have with the Russians out in Colorado Springs. Make sure we don't blow each other up accidentally over the rollover day. Okay? Authority on tap, or the first strike issue, really, is when we worry about information warfare defensive. All those computer attacks that could or could not occur. And if they do occur, how do you explain to people that it's not Y2K? That'll be really hard. Keeping up appearances or opportunists abound, we say you may have to engage in counter-terror crisis response. A backlash against Americans, you're talking about the possibility of non-combat evacuation operations, NEOs. And if all this stuff's going on here, we say you may have to consider the use of information offensive warfare, special operations forces, even covert forces, because you may have situations that are too big to ignore, or you may have opportunities too good to pass up. A North Korea, which is torturing its people slowly, may come under real stress with a Y2K. If you could just give them a little nudge and turn it into a Berlin Wall falling down, everybody could have a better life tomorrow. It may be a real temptation. Just briefly, a SYNCS dynamic grid. Some of the issues and decisions we think SYNCS are going to face in this process. We're just going to highlight one simple part of it. Operational choices here. Going across here, we're going to talk about during the mania phase, degree of outreach, how much you're going to speak and be honest with allies and non-allies, how much you're going to come clean with people. I think these issues are analogous to things that USAID may face. Countdown, it's all about force posture. Are you going to be spread out or are you going to be sucked back in at home? How much are you going to be out there showing people you're part of the response immediately? Or are you going to wait and take a SWAT team approach to things? Onset, it all comes down to how long you're going to wait versus how soon you should move. Unfolding situation, it's all about triage, deciding how to decide who to help and who to help first. A lot of our workshop a couple weeks ago was on that issue, selection criteria. Peak situation is a question of how much it's worth to you, so how much do you throw in? If you're USAID, do you waste a big chunk of your budget 1 year? Because people may look back at that in Senate investigations and say, why didn't you do something? Sitting around with your money and all that, you know, we know you're 15% of the U.S. federal budget. Why couldn't you just reach into your deep pockets and take care of the world's problems? And then when to declare victory, which may be a problem you have to deal with. Because we may be celebrating like Ryder Cup, you know, we're all dancing on the green going, yay, America wins. And then China may be suffering desperately at the same time. Or in India, or in Indonesia. And that may be an issue you have to end up dealing with. So we talk about U.S. government looking to outcome some of the legacy issues. We build a very simple four-box set here. We'll say it could go as such. The U.S. could be not so bad, or it could be a bad time. And the rest of the world could be not so bad or bad time. That gets you four boxes, four outcomes, four legacies. If it's not bad for either one, we say the key legacy here is going to be one of the Rorschach test. Everybody's going to look back at Y2K and say, aha, it proves what exactly I thought beforehand, which is the West is evil, the West is good, the new economy is good, the new economy is evil, Bill Gates is Christ, Bill Gates is Antichrist, Alan Greenspan runs everything, Alan Greenspan controls nothing, Islam is good, Islam is bad. It'll prove whatever you want to prove. If it's bad for the United States, not bad for the rest of the world, least likely outcome, but it would be a very humbling experience for the United States. We would think we had it all down, and then boom, we'd be hit for a loop right on the eve of a presidential election. And I would say Pat Buchanan's chances, go way up at that point. Atlas shrugged. We take our marbles and go home. Least likely outcome. Most likely outcome, not bad for us, indeterminately worse for the rest of the world. That's the basic call right now most people offer. What is indeterminately worse? That's the real question. And how much should we care? How much damage can it do to us on the rebound, for example? So we may win the battle here, end up losing the peace by pissing off a lot of people around the planet. And then if it's bad for us, bad for the rest of the world, that's the real dilemma. Do you try to play sysadmin to the entire world, feel everybody's pain a little bit, or at some point do you turn into the Yellowstone National Park Fire Department of a few years back? And you say, sometimes, baby, it's just got to burn. It's nature's way. If you prevent lots of little forest fires, all you're going to get is a big forest fire. So you draw a big firewall around your country and you say, sorry, see you later. Can't help you. We're not responsible for everything. And if you do, what kind of legacy are you going to deal with on that basis? A few words on Wall Street. Very different perspective, but I think very illuminating for USAID in general. If this had happened back in 1995, frankly, everybody would have said, who cares? The global economy is working perfectly in 95. Okay, since then we've had some real stresses. Mexican pesos crisis was our first catch of maybe our first view of a new type of crisis in 1994. Then 97, 98, global financial crisis starts in Asia, jumps to Russia when oil prices drop, jumps mysteriously to Brazil one afternoon when we discover two Nobel Prize winning economists in Connecticut made a huge bet using $4 billion of their own money and $10 billion of OPM, other people's money. Their bet was gas prices, oil prices up, treasuries down. They were wrong. And when they were wrong, they had to pay off all their people really fast. And guess where they got the money? They jerked it out of Brazil one afternoon. That's how the crisis went from Asia to Russia to Brazil, which frankly at that point put up its hands and said, hey, what did I do? Well, they got in bed with two Nobel Prize winning economists. Shame on you, Brazil. You talk about an EU economic slump, which they're just coming out of. US is the sole global engine for the global economy for a while now. So what if Y2K comes along, a millennial panic? Are we talking a possible global crisis? That's the prediction of some people. And I can tell you, going back to 1599, there have been financial panics in global supermarkets, global financial markets, going back to 1599 with the Dutch stock market. In 1899, in our country, there was an irrational drop in New York Stock Exchange, about 20-25% in a two-week period in December. Completely unexplainable. It happens almost every time, though, for whatever reason. The larger argument here is as follows. You can talk about Globalization I, an era from roughly 1880 to 1929, when we all came together in the first big globalizing period of the global economy. Okay, and it all stops one afternoon, 1929, on Wall Street, Black Friday. A systemic stress ensues. We call it the Great Depression. From the Great Depression, we get World War II. At the end of World War II, we say, we're never going to let that happen again. We're never going to let that slide into economic nationalism, take us down that horrible path again. We're going to firewall ourselves off in that experience. Okay, we're going to introduce a new global rule set. That global rule set is going to be IMF, GATT, World Bank, UN, gold standard. All these things are never going to let that happen again. And it works wonderfully. The real story of the second half of the 20th century is the emergence of the global economy, not the Cold War. This is the good stuff. The question now is, are we experiencing new stresses in the late 1990s that call into question what looked like a great rule set in the late 1940s, early 50s, but now looks kind of old? Designed to prevent the collapse of a previous sort of globalization. Globalization, too, is not uncontested trade of raw materials between peripheries and home worlds, colonialization. Globalization, too, is a Honda built in Ohio with parts from 30 different countries. That is far more complex. Could something come down the pike that makes us say, hey, we got to wall ourselves off in the late 1990s, all that instability, you remember it. It was called the Millennium Financial Panic. I lost a lot of money. And what would the new global rule set be? A lot of people say, let's put all sorts of controls on the short-term movement of financial capital around the world, which the United States abhors, because we make a lot of money doing that. Probably everybody in this room makes a lot of money doing that, whether you realize it or not. That's how you make money. You take from the bad, and you give to the good. So we had our Wall Street people all sitting around a table in May. We said, mania in a countdown. What can happen between now and December 31st? We said, the big thing we should worry about in our minds is flight to quality. This is what we heard from them. Pro-panic argument. The market's never had so many idiots. We're long overdue for a correction. They worry about the U.S. domestic electronic herd, people doing stuff with their money because they hear things on the AM radio. They call them the AM radio crowd. Not the NPR people. We know you people will behave. But the AM radio crowd, those people. And then we're worried about Congress being on the sidelines over liability back in May. Since then, of course, Congress passed this bill. The president signed it. People said, wow, great for business. Other people said, wow, great for big business. Small guys still gonna get shafted royally. Anti-panic arguments. The 97-98 global financial crisis actually vaccinated us against this kind of movement of money. Back in 95, there were lots of hot gypsy funds traveling the world at high speeds. When the financial panic hit in 97, a lot of people got much less naive about emerging markets, much more oversight of hedge funds like long-term capital management, those two Nobel Prize winners in Connecticut. So there's less money out there to slop around and do dangerous things. If there is a flight to quality, it'll be into U.S. securities, government debt, or it'll just go into mid-caps and cyclicals, even out the stock market. And that would probably be a good thing. The Fed's ready to give money away like crazy. They have a special unit set up within the Fed. Gives money away. They will give you banks money, and they'll count almost anything as collateral. Greenspan set this up. Starts November 1st. It goes through March 7th. I call it the virtual George Bailey. Banks are going to come to it and say, I'm freaking out. My people are freaking out. Give me some money. And they'll say, wow, what do you really need? Bank America, can I give you $20 million? Get you through the weekend? Come on. I know you. You know me. That kind of stuff. Europe says they feel Y2K okay. They think the skill set they mastered to introduce the EMU, the European Monetary Unit, is much like the skill set Wall Street says they mastered with the global financial crisis 97-98. They said, we've seen this beast. It's called stay light on your feet. Okay, we think we can handle it. The majority of the people that we talked to on Wall Street said this is what they see happening. Anti-panic. So we tried to scare them again. We said onset unfolding. Possibility of markets going broke. What does that mean? Everybody wants to sell on a particular market, say Turkish bonds. Nobody wants to buy. Paper value drops. It's illiquid. Everybody wants to sell. Nobody wants to buy. Great way to have a panic. What we heard, pro-crash arguments. Oil can do it. We talked to DOE. We said, what would happen to drive oil prices up in this country? They said a 3-4% slowdown in the flow of oil coming in the United States. What did we say? What Tom Clancy-like scenario has to happen for that to happen? They said, bad paperwork at megaports is enough. I said, that doesn't sound very sexy. It doesn't sound like a novel or anything. They said, well, that's life. Enterprise software that creates those just-in-time margins that are razor thin. First big test. If they work, great. If they don't, we're in trouble. Countries that don't let outsiders help are going to be at big risk. And countries that have not learned from the advice after the 97-98 financial crisis, who were told to reform and didn't, they're going to be at the bottom of the list from the international financial institutions to get help. Anti-crash arguments. We're going to predict these losses. If they happen, we'll know them. Firm IT lockdown in late 1999 triggers this pent-up release of products, new products coming from Silicon Valley. They anticipated people would buy last second half of 99 because they got all their Y2K systems in order, and they said, I'm not going to mess with that. Now, the evidence is the slowdown has been slight, mostly in high-end servers and data acquisition software programs. But what we found is that people bought heavy in the first half of the year. So it seems like a slowdown in the second half of the year because they're not buying heavy now. But Silicon Valley's ready for that. Lots of good stuff's going to happen. Wall Street says expect a boom in the first half of next year. The usual January effect in markets. If the U.S. stock market goes up at the end of the first week in January, 8 out of 10 times, it'll go up for the rest of the year. Little secret. People see that. They go, wow, that looks good. If they took all their cash out because they're worried about this or that, guess where they put their cash back in? Back in the stock market. All of a sudden, you got a virtuous cycle. Everything looks hunky-dory. And then the 97-98 graduates will be protected by international aid. My example to show the difference between those two. Ministry of Finance, South Korea, was under a currency attack in December 1997. Okay, IMF came to them and said, what do you got in U.S. Dollars in reserves? Minister of Finance looked them straight in the eye and lied. He said, I have 30 billion U.S. He had 10 billion U.S. The international electronic herd, as Tom Friedman would call them, found out about it and bankrupted them within 24 hours. Basically spent them all the way down so that the Ministry of Finance had to say, well, we can't support this currency anymore. Today, anybody in the world can get an email from the Minister of Finance himself that will tell you exactly what they have in U.S. reserves at the end of every business day, down to the last penny. They learned a very important lesson. It is called, tell the truth or we will screw you over on the basis of rumors. Again, the majority was this. So we tried to scare them one more time. We said, as bad as it's going to get, we think lots of small and medium enterprise failures will be dramatic. What we heard from Wall Street, pro-downturn arguments, social unrest factor, don't underestimate it. The U.S. cannot be the sole global engine, and if anybody thinks IMF can play FDIC to the world, you are living in a land of illusion. Worse than expected first quarter earnings, that can be dangerous. And then we don't know about those long-term capital management bets until they come a cropper, frankly. People say we have more oversight, but I really doubt it. Pro-boom arguments. U.S. firms are going to treat this as an opportunity to expand market shares, not as a failure point. Winner-take-all nature of the new economy is based on a high SME failure rate anyway. I call it the T-Rex economy. You've got these giants like Microsoft walking around. And when they see those little dinosaurs that get just a little meat on their bones, they reach over and they eat them in one fell swoop. And then they lean back up, they belch, they turn to the next T-Rex over and they say, don't worry, there are a lot of these things running around all over the place. They grow like weeds. We can eat all afternoon. That's how the new economy is based. Small and medium enterprises, startup companies, get good. As soon as they got a product, big guy comes in, eats them. It's not a bad thing, it's a good thing. Fortressing, if it does happen, won't be about cutting off your vendors and suppliers. It'll be more about upgrading. This is an issue we explored a lot in the workshops at AID. If you have critical failures in the country, do you come in and try to rebuild that mess, or do you give them a compact laptop, a few cell phones, and say, this is the future. Forget the past. Learn. And then finally, the big argument, great housekeeping along with Y2K, plus the market efficiencies, all those SMEs disappearing, that's going to create a boom. Again, that was our majority opinion. So at the end of the workshop with Wall Street, one of the people there said, you know, I see Y2K as kind of a deadline for entrance into the new economy of the next century. And the question for anybody is, are you ready? Have you mastered the skill sets that get you past Y2K? You need to, because if you're not, you're probably not developing or thriving in the new economy anyway. So in fact, there is no escaping Y2K. Get used to it. There's always going to be a Y2K, another one coming down the pike, another set of problems. Who do we worry about? We worry about emerging economies. You should worry about emerging economies. Why? Because the 90s have been not very good to them. 1989, 91, we asked a lot of countries with strong authoritarian pasts to democratize and be quick about it. Berlin Wall comes down. We say, turn into democracies. Now! Clinton, Rubin, Benson, they come into power in 92, 96. They want to open up the world to U.S. financial instruments. They succeed dramatically. They succeed so dramatically, some people think they caused the 97-98 financial crisis. And what did we do right then? We looked at these countries and we said, by God, you're full of all sorts of bad practices. Reform and be quick about it. Otherwise, we might jack our money out of your economy overnight. And then 1999 comes along and we say, well, we got a new task for you. It's called get all your IT systems in order. And if you don't, we have any concerns about it as the key date approaches, we may just jack all our money out of your economy. So be afraid. Be very afraid. When people say the U.S. is a global bully economically, that we're constantly threatening people and demanding they change according to our way of thinking, it's because they're observant and they have a memory. Who's Wall Street going to bet on?
Yeah, baby. Yeah.
Countries that look like us. Countries that have lots of rules and transparency. That are countries that are new economy. Countries that tend to be wealthy. But the key thing is, are you IT savvy? Virtual tigers will be bet on. Your Israel, your Wadi Valley, your Ireland, your Singapore, your virtual tigers. Don't own a lot, but know a lot and know how to sell. And then countries who learned from the 97-98 financial crisis. Who are we going to bet against, they say? Just the opposite. And it's going to be just that stark. These people are going to find extra money available. These people are going to find less money available. That's how it works. You take from the incompetence and you give to the competence. It's cruel. It's called the market. Okay, I'm going to spend about 5 minutes here wrapping this up, and then we're going to run off and do this all over again for the administrator. But I don't like to shortchange you. You've been a good audience. We've talked a lot about a lot of scary things over the last hour and a half. At this point, I'd like everybody to kind of relax. Shake out all those bad vibes. Back away from the problem just a little bit and ask yourself, what are some key things we can learn from Y2K big picture-wise? Okay? We didn't realize this, but we've been creating a mental model throughout the course of this workshop series. And what I just showed you was a series of models. A model of models is what I'm talking about here now. A meta model. How we built this mental model is as follows. In September, that's when we created, back in 98, the onset models, the weather analogies. We said, that's great. It takes us about 5 minutes into the show. We got to do a little better. So in October, we came up with a four workshop organization. We couldn't draw this now, then, but we claim we knew it all along. In December, we had our first workshop. That's where we developed the outcome models. The humans one, computer zero stuff. So we said, good, we got it coming and going. Now let's figure out the hard part in the middle. In January, we had all our regional experts come. That's when we developed the black box model in the middle. Okay. In March, we brought together the OSD, Paul Mill, DOD crowd. We said, what can the military do to exacerbate or moderate this black box model? And then in May, we went to Wall Street and we said, what do you think the supermarkets around the world can do to exacerbate or moderate this black box model? In July, we put our report out on the internet. It's all available, free of charge. And then since October, we've been working legacy issues like our workshops here at AID. And we had a special one with the Department of Navy Chief Information Officer as well. Now, I talk to the press all the time. This is obviously too complex to tell somebody in the press. They want something real fast over the phone in about 5 minutes. They want a sound bite, frankly. So I developed, instead of the metal model, I developed what I call a miniature meta model.
I shall call him Mini.
My Mini-Me model. Two simple questions for all those emails I get from housewives and dentists building bomb shelters in Boulder, Colorado and whatnot. I say, ask yourself two questions. Hardware question. The country you're worried about, is it distributed or less distributed? Software question. The country you're worried about, is it more new economy or less new economy? Gets you four outcomes. This is how I'm going to string together all those models very simply. Okay? If it's very new economy and very distributed, that's your best case. Frankly, that's the United States. That's why I don't worry about the United States. More interesting case, it doesn't look very modern, and yet it may be more new economy than we realize. That's your next best case. My choice there is China. I think we may be surprised by how well private China handles Y2K. I think we may be surprised. I think public China may be surprised by how shown up it is. And when public China is shown up, as we know with Falun Gong, it tends to get pretty nervous, pretty reactionary. So I worry about a Taiwan crisis or something like that coming out of this, because public China decides it needs to rally the nation quickly, and it's got a perfect way to do it. An interesting situation is a country that looks really modern, but actually is not very new economy. That's Japan in my mind. They abhor the strong eats the rich kind of thinking. They subsidize all sorts of stuff. Their kiritsu, the major conglomerations, they can't even fire their long-term hires known as Yakuza. They're actually mafia. They can't fire them unless they talk to their pension boss and make it all work out. Give them kind of a retirement package. I mean, a culture that can't even fire your mobsters without talking to a pension boss guy. That is not very Bill Gates. And then the worst situation, not distributed, not new economy, we worry about a country like Iran. Frankly, it has one answer for everything. Mono economy, mono polity, mono society, mono everything. If the one answer breaks down, they're in trouble. In the United States, we always have another answer. Another political party, another theory, another this or that. Countries that don't have answers, they're the ones you worry about. So one of the issues we take from Y2K is, one of the cosmic conclusions, how you look at it depends on from when you look at it. If you look at it from the past, you say, I've never seen this before. It's unique in human history. You get this all the time. But we say if you look at it from the future, it's actually a harbinger for the kind of system perturbations we're going to deal with again and again and again. It's really different in degree from the kinds of things you say will deal with again and again and again. We say get off the have versus have not thing. Start thinking more in terms of competence versus incompetence. 21st century economy that we all want to get to. This could be a separation point in global economic development. Those who are IT competent, they're going to go there faster on the basis of Y2K. Those who are incompetent, they're going to get used up and tossed aside and left behind. Historically, when you have a separation point in human economic development, it's a bad thing. Some fall behind faster, some get ahead faster, and guess what? You get revolutions, you get wars, you get people angry. So one of the things we're going to take, our last cosmic conclusion, is as follows. Y2K is a serious glimpse into our collective future. Our argument, a bit fortune cookie style delivered, is that divisions will no longer be vertical, but more horizontal. What we mean by that is follows. Economic pain in the past has more descriptively been presented in terms of vertical divisions. And we call those vertical divisions borders. So we have economic pain during hard times, and we say country A seems to be doing better than country B. Okay? We say Y2K and the IT nature of it and the new economy that it describes or illuminates tells us that in the future, pain will be distributed much more horizontally. You will have a top layer of an economy anywhere in the world that does well with this, and you will have a much larger lower level that doesn't do well with this. The divisions will not be between countries. It will be between social economic layers. So if the 20th century is a century of internation warfare, Y2K alerts us to the fact that the 21st century will likely be a century of intranational civil strife. And that's very different. A last image to leave you with, Y2K and the start of the millennium. What does it all mean? Consider this.
It's the end of the world as we know it. It's the end of the world.